Grace and peace to you in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Good morning and welcome to this service of worship here at Duke University Chapel. We are so glad that you have come to worship here today. And whether you're worshiping with us in person or through one of our media outlets, we are glad that you are joining us. Our desire today is to honor and worship our Lord through word and action in our songs and our prayers and all that we say and do. May we worship together today in spirit and in truth. It's a joy to have with us the Trinity Choir from Trinity Episcopal Church in Stanton, Virginia. They told me how to pronounce it because I was trying to pronounce the U. Don't do that. It's Stanton, Virginia. We thank you so much for your gift of music today, and we thank you that you have decided to be away from your home church to be with us in worship. The choir will also be leading us in worship this afternoon in our 4 p.m. Evensong service. This is one of two summer Evensong services that we are having this summer, and the next one is next week, so we hope that you'll come and join us in worship in those services as well. We are delighted today to have Reverend Dr. Lisa L. Thompson as our Howard C. Wilkinson guest preacher. This is a homecoming of sorts for Reverend Dr. Thompson, as she is from Cedar Grove, North Carolina. We're also delighted to have some of her family and friends here with us today. Dr. Thompson currently serves at Union Theological Seminary in New York, and we are so glad that you are here, and we look forward to the word that you will bring us from the Lord. As we continue in worship today, may we find ourselves drawn to Jesus, the one who invites us all to come to him because his yoke is easy and his burden is light. Let us stand to sing together.
God has spoken to us, yet we have not always listened. God is revealed to us in Jesus Christ, yet we are slow to respond. Trusting divine mercy, let us turn to God in prayer, confessing our sins. Let us pray. Holy God, we are a generation that hears your invitation, but does not always follow. We see the ways of Jesus, but do not take them to heart. Lord, have mercy. Gracious Lord, we do not understand our own actions, for we do not do what we want, and we often do the very thing we hate. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Loving Spirit, when we carry heavy burdens, Jesus offers us rest, yet we often refuse to let go of all that weighs us down. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Merciful Savior, you invite us to take your yoke upon us, saying that your yoke is easy and your burden is light. Help us to turn from all of the sin and brokenness that fills our lives and draw us to yourself once again, that we may live as your faithful disciples and in you find our true rest. It is in your holy name that we pray. Amen. The psalmist declares that the Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. The Lord is good to all, and his compassion is over all that he has made. God's mercy is decisively revealed to us in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And in Christ, we find new life. Friends, hear and believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. As God's forgiven people, let us now turn to one another to share the peace of Christ.
Please join me for the prayer for illumination printed in your bulletin. Gracious Father, by the obedience of Jesus, you brought salvation to our wayward world. Send your Spirit now to illuminate your holy word through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The Old Testament lesson is from Zechariah, the 9th chapter. Rejoice greatly, O daughter Zion. Shout aloud, O daughter Jerusalem. Lo, your king comes to you, triumphant and victorious is he, humble and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. He will cut off the chariot from Ephraim and the war horse from Jerusalem, and the battle bow shall be cut off, and he shall command peace to the nations. His dominion shall be from sea to sea, and from the river to the ends of the earth. As for you also, because of the blood of my covenant with you, I will set your prisoners free from the waterless pit. Return to your stronghold, O prisoners of hope. Today I declare that I will restore to you double. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you.
The New Testament lesson is from Romans, the 7th chapter. I do not understand my own actions, for I do not do what I want, but I do the very thing I hate. Now, if I do what I do not want, I agree that the law is good. But in fact, it is no longer I that do it, but sin that dwells within me. For I know that nothing good dwells within me, that is, in my flesh. I can will what is right, but I cannot do it. For I do not do the good I want, but the evil I do not want is what I do. Now if I do what I do not want, it is no longer I that do it, but sin that dwells within me. So I find it to be a law that when I want to do what is good, evil lies close at hand. For I delight in the law of God in my inmost self, but I see in my members another law at war with the law of my mind, making me captive to the law of sin that dwells in my members. Wretched man that I am, who will rescue me from this body of death? Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then, with my mind, I am a slave to the law of God, but with my flesh, I am a slave to the law of sin. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The gospel lesson is from Matthew, the 11th chapter. Jesus said to the crowd, "But to what will I compare this generation? It is like children sitting in the marketplaces and calling to one another. We played the flute for you, and you did not dance. We wailed, and you did not mourn. For John came neither eating nor drinking, and they say, 'He has a demon.' The Son of Man came eating and drinking, and they say, 'Look, a glutton and a drunkard, a friend of tax collectors and sinners.' Yet wisdom is vindicated by her deeds." At that time, Jesus said, "I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and the intelligent and have revealed them to infants. Yes, Father, for such was your gracious will. All things have been handed over to me by my Father, and no one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son and anyone to whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Come to me, all you that are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. This is the word of the Lord.
Good morning. I greet you in the name of our living God who moves among us still today. I am so gracious and graciously glad to be with you this morning and humbled by the invitation from Dean Luke Powery, Reverend Puckett, and Reverend Greg, and even the hospitality of Mr. Adams and all those who work so hard to make worship happen in this gorgeous cathedral this morning, from those who sweep the floors and fold the bulletins and meet us with smiles at the door. Thank you so much. And I have to give special thanks because I'm in a special place that's not too far from home. And I can't give thanks but so long because I might cry, but I see my village is in the building, and it is very rare that I get to be in spaces with the people who support me and nurtured me from birth, those who are siblings by kin and by friend, those who are cousins and aunties, and lo and behold, my mother and my father, who tolerated my questions. When I was little, I had lots of questions. I hope you think the questions paid off a little bit. I am still one with lots of questions. And today, I stand with more questions than I may have answers. I have to admit that some days, I wonder why we still read this book that we call sacred. For on many days, and on more days than not, I pick up this holy writ and find myself utterly confused about what's really going on in the text. Today may be one of those days. A text of multiple conversations, strange stories, stories of children hanging out in the marketplace, dancing and mourning, but no one dancing with them and no one mourning with them, making noise and seemingly abrupt endings that are tidy, inviting us to rest and to come. I had a teacher, a mentor, and friend who used to say, "I often have more questions than I have answers." And as the years go by, I feel like there are days when I have more questions than I have answers. And I'm sure that if we dared on the side of honesty and admit that no matter how neatly our lectionaries, traditions, Sunday school lessons, and Bible school lessons lay text alongside of each other as though they make sense together, we often still walk away scratching our heads, trying to figure out, what does this really mean? What is this all about? I can't make sense of it all. Again, if we dare to err on the side of honesty, there is a natural impulse within us to order and make sense of things that we do not understand. We create categories of our own into which we want things to fit neatly. For the sake of understanding, we will often push a round peg into a square hole just because it needs to fit. Whether we admit it or not, we often try to make sense of things, order them, name people, ascribe and describe people based on our need to know, or our need to make sense of that which we do not understand or know. If you give a toddler a round ball and you tell them, that's a square. And if you do it enough times, no matter how many times they see the four-cornered object we really call a square, that object is not a square. The sphere is a square. That object in that nimble and developing mind is not a square, but that round thing is the square. That four-cornered object may be many things, but to this toddler, it is not a square. I can hear the inner working thoughts of this little developing being saying, I do not yet know how to make sense of this thing in front of me, but that's not what I know to be a square. I can almost see this developing, nimble, and curious little one begin internally pondering what they had perceived and placing it alongside of new information that they are now receiving and now having some questions arise within them. Well, I thought this was a square, but now you're telling me this is a square? It doesn't make sense. This little one has a few options. Double down. We know toddlers, they double down. No, this is a square. Or, in good toddler fashion, why? Translation, prove it, mommy. Tell me it's a square. Or they may have the option to pick it up and play with it a while, declaring square, square, square. This too is a square. We engage in a constant process of trying to make sense of things, sense of the world, sense of God and faith. And today, to be honest, I am still not convinced that I have any complete answers or have made sense of anything in Matthew chapter 11. I know it makes you a little nervous. It makes me a little nervous too, because I'm supposed to preach. But before we get too nervous, I am a little convinced that making sense of things is or might not be the ultimate aim for us. That every time making sense might not be the ultimate aim of our existence here on this earth. However, I am convinced that if we are willing to journey into a passage that may leave us with more questions then we have answers, we may be willing to move about in the lines, letters, and spaces of that text while listening a little deeper. If we are willing to err on the side of honesty and to ask more questions than we need to have answers for, we may be able to listen a little deeply, a little differently. So for our hearing and listening hearts, I would like to read again Matthew chapter 11, but beginning at the first verse. After Jesus had finished instructing his 12 disciples, he went out there to teach and preach in the towns of Galilee. When John, who was in prison, heard about the deeds of the Messiah, he sent his disciples to ask him, "Are you the one who is to come, or should we expect someone else?" Jesus replied, "Go back and report to John what you hear and see. The blind receive sight, the lame walk, those who have leprosy are cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, and the good news is proclaimed to the poor. Blessed is anyone who does not stumble on account of me." As John's disciples were leaving, Jesus began to speak to the crowd about John. "What did you go into the wilderness to see? A reed swayed by the wind? If not, what did you go out to see? a man dressed in fine clothes? No, those who wear fine clothes are in the king's palaces. Then what did you go out to see? A prophet? Yes, I tell you, and more than a prophet. This is the one about whom it is written, I will send my messenger ahead of you who will prepare for you a way before you. Truly, I tell you, among those born of women, there has never risen anyone greater than John the Baptist. Yet whoever is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. From the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven has been subjected to violence, and violent people have been raiding it. For all the prophets and all the law prophesied until John. And if you are willing to accept it, he is Elijah, who has come. Whoever has listening hearts, let them listen. To what can I compare this generation? They are like children sitting in the marketplaces and calling out to others, we played the pipe for you and you did not dance. We sang a dirge for you and you did not mourn. For John came neither eating nor drinking, and they say, he has a demon. The Son of Man came eating and drinking, and they say, here is a glutton and a drunkard, a friend of tax collectors and sinners. But wisdom is proved right by her deeds. Verse 25, at that time Jesus said, I praise, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, praise you who have hidden these things from the wise and learned and revealed them to little children. Yes, Father, for this is what you were pleased to do. All things have been committed to me by my Father. No one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and those to whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Whew. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burdens light. Here ends the reading of the word. Seems like we are not the only ones who desire to make sense of things and place things in categories so that we might name them, know them, prove them as right and wrong, normal or other. Chapter 11 begins with John the Baptist trying to make sense of some things. Truly, John is the very one who declared the coming of the Messiah in the wilderness. John is the one who baptized Jesus. John, the one who saw the clouds and the sun peel back from the sky while the Spirit of the Lord descended on Jesus to announce, this is my beloved Son, the one in whom I am well pleased. This same John from prison now has some questions and is trying to make sense of things, and particularly trying to make sense of the way in which Jesus is moving about in the world, about the way in which Jesus is doing some things. I have to imagine his current imprisonment has him asking questions about the unfolding of things. So he sends his crew out to meet Jesus in the streets where Jesus is preaching, teaching, holding court, and partaking of some spirited libations of sorts. And he asks Jesus one question, are you really the one? Or should we wait for another? Jesus needs to make sense of some things for John. John isn't the only one who has questions. The people around Jesus have some questions of their own about John. They want to know if John was the prophet they had long been waiting for to announce the anointed one of God. Everyone needs to make sense of things and what is happening around Jesus. Everyone is asking Jesus to prove it. Let me know for sure that this is where I should direct my attention. Isn't that just like us? Jesus, you're kicking it in the streets, having feasts, partaking of some spirited libations. John is fasting out in the wilderness as a minimalist. Which one of you are doing it right? Which one of you are the right one? Which one of you are the way? And the questions hit Jesus. And to these questions, Jesus simply responds, we are both the one. I am not going to let you parse the way out into neat and tidy lanes. Yes, John's the one. Yes, I am the one. Jesus seems less concerned about sorting out the means to the kingdom of heaven, the right methods and the route. And Jesus seems more concerned about the fruits of the kingdom of heaven. That which the kingdom of heaven produces and makes possible seems to be Jesus' main concern. Jesus says, forget the need to make sense of things. Go back and tell John what you have witnessed, what you have seen, what you have heard. The results prove their own point. Tell me, or tell John, that you have seen God's kingdom come to earth. God's kingdom, good news proclaimed to the poor. Tell him that you have seen God's kingdom come to earth, the push for freedom for all who are held captive, no matter their chains or no matter the cost of their bonds. Go tell John what you have seen, God's kingdom come to earth, the brokenhearted, mended. God's kingdom come to earth, comfort for those who mourn and weep. God's kingdom come to earth, joy that is resolute in the midst of deep, deep sorrow. God's kingdom. The affirmation of nothing less than life over death. Go tell John what you have seen. God's vision that continuously breaks into this world from time to time, for we, the created of God, often defies our expectations for how and where it shows up. Jesus ate, John the Baptist fasted. Some mourn, some dance. For it is not our vision, but God's vision. For it is God's vision for the family, God's kingdom, not ours. We see one drum beat through each movement of this text. Yes, that is God's way. Yes, that too is God's way. No, you will not always be able to make sense of it. Yes, it will forever be God's way, even when you cannot make sense of it all. This way belongs to God and not to us. But God says, if you join me and trust this thing that is otherworldly to you, I promise to show myself to you. You will gain a glimpse of none other than that which is sacred and true if you join me. If you are willing to accept it, if those who have hearts to listen, listen, come, take, learn, rest. Jesus offers an open invitation. The opportunity is yours. I freely give it if you will take me up on my offer. Lay down your burden of proof. Exchange your need of proof for the opportunity to join me right here, right now, where I am working and where I am moving. Turn away from what you thought and set your face towards a new direction. The one that I only reveal to you, the only way I will reveal this to you, if you come, if you take, and if you rest in me and not in yourselves. Come. Take rest in me and not yourselves. Jesus extends an invitation to trust. This is a call to trust the way of God and to trust a way and vision that is not our vision. And even with all the questions and all the tidy endings, I still have more questions. I am convinced that on some days, this is the place where we get stuck. Instead of our freely receiving an invitation without strings attached, we are still tempted to look around and say, prove it, God. The burden of needing proof, our need to make sense of it all, becomes a stumbling block to joining in on holy glimmers, when, wherever, and however they manifest themselves in our world. When and however. No, instead, we get caught debating square over sphere. What could it be and what can't be possible for God? Who's in and who's out? Who's real or who's fake? What's going to be the outcome? We get so caught here that we miss the invitation to simply come. God says, try me. Just try me. turn it over for the opportunity to join me. The irony is that whether we accept or don't accept the invitation of God, God will continue to work with or without us. John's question did not stop the ministry of Jesus. The people's question about John did not stop the ministry of John in and of itself. And because it is God's work, not our work, God's plan and not our plan, we're invited to the party. But the music isn't going to stop if we choose not to dance. God moaning for and with creation isn't going to stop because we decided to close our hearts and turn our heads. The prophets will continue to declare good news. The God of this creation, our Creator, will continue to move forward with or without you. But the invitation is open. Come. And again, here is where I have more questions. Because I am a child of questions. In some ways, we can indeed say, fine, missed opportunity. I missed out, my loss. And God could even say, your loss. And in fact, there are days in which I am convinced God says, you're a free agent, fine. Your loss, not mine. I'm still working. There is a piece of me that wants to say, fine, to each their own. And fine, all are for themselves and free to make decisions for themselves. Fine, bow out and bow into the work of God whenever you see fit. But there is also something that gives me pause when I think about the option of bowing in and out whenever we see fit to do the work of God or to not join in on the work of God. There is something that gives me pause about the freedom of choice. When we take another glance at our text, there is something that appears as a passing statement that we can easily gloss over in verse 12. In the midst of all the misrecognition, the willful lack of recognition that God is at work right there in the midst of the unexpected places, Jesus says, from the days of John the Baptist into now, the kingdom of heaven has been subjected to violence. And the violent people have been raiding it or taking it by force. I have to pause. The creation of God suffers violence. The vision of God is taken over violently. The body of God has hands forced upon it that did not have the right to touch it in the first place. The hope of God has been assaulted and left scattered about the streets and ditches of the world. The will of God has been cut off by visible and invisible nooses hanging in trees. The pleasures of God have been subverted by the need and claim for greed that keeps our boots on the necks of others. The free-moving spirit of God has been forcefully sequestered to pews, crosses, as clanging cymbals that allow us to deal death, utterly destroy and deny the image of God that moves about this world on the streets around us, embodied in flesh. Violence is the risk of our misrecognition or intentional refusal to ignore the movement and the work of God in our world and in our very own lives. God is concerned about our personal rest and well-being, and God is concerned about so much more. I cannot help but to imagine the vision of God's kingdom suffering violence as more than a metaphor or cute passing phrase. I cannot help but imagine it as so when I think about John the Baptist being in prison and facing death as the prophet of whom people were trying to make sense. We cannot imagine violence as something little as a metaphor when we know that Jesus and the way in which Jesus moved about in the world was ultimately what led to his public execution. Because of the acts of God he was determined to carry out, and they were misrecognized. We cannot think of this as a simple metaphor when some of us, as the created of God, know what it is not to have food to eat, not to have a place to lay our head, cannot get the medication and attention our bodies need, and the way that sorrow pierces some of our souls in ways that leave us without an utter word. The risk is too great for us not to join in on God's work. The risk is too great for us to ignore the invitation of God to come. I honestly imagine this invitation at the end of chapter 11 as a question. Will you be the impressionable one or the rigid one? Will you come? Because often God lies at the fringes, the edges, the cracks, the ruptures, and the discontinuous places in life and the world where we would least perceive God. Not necessarily in the neat packages with direct answers, with clear-cut plans and strategies for the entire picture. I have to believe that on many days, it is less about right and wrong and more about moving where God is moving. What would happen if by faith we were to make a new move? What would happen if by faith we were to place ourselves right in the crossroads? What would happen if we were to survey and ask the ancient paths, where is the good and fitting way? What would happen if we listened deeply and moved in the direction to which the deep called us? What would happen if we exchange our burden of proof, exchange our knowing for sure, and exchange our sense-making for rest? And not just the rest of our weary souls, but the rest of every weary soul. While I say we do not have all the answers, we have some hints that the kingdom of God is at hand. The kingdom brings in justice, peace, comfort, sets the prisoners free, brings rest to war-torn bodies, clothes people back in their right mind whom this world have unnecessarily stripped of their right mind. I have a feeling that if we were to say yes, yes, God, every soul waiting on justice would see the kingdom break in. I have a feeling that if we were to say yes, yes, God, every literal body waiting to inhale deeply would find the breath of God. I have a feeling that if we dare to say yes, God, I'll come, every prisoner of hope would be set free. The children, the infants, those who we might presently think. I'm sorry, the children, the infants, those who might presently think that the sphere is a triangle or a square sit at a peculiar place in a peculiar space. They sit right at the cusp of what they have known, what they know, and the way they have been shaped up until this point. And they also sit at the opportunity for their horizons to be expanded, swelled a bit beyond their current capacity. They sit at the cusp of rigidity and doubling down, or the cusp of curiosity and willingness to move an inch or so beyond what they currently know. They sit at the cusp of stability and instability, constant and shifting, adaptation and perception. In earnest, the child, the infant, the malleable one sits at the fringes of truth, having, and often more willing to adapt to the shifting world as it comes to know more about wisdom and truth itself. Indeed, there are new moves and alternative paths possible in faith if we seek and search them out, even in places where they are already being laid. And the gift is the constant invitation to come, take rest, rest not in what you know, but rest in God. God says, try me. This is my prayer for us. Amen.
This morning, as we come to a time of prayer, I invite you to pray for the wailing family. as Chuck Whaling, a member of the congregation, died peacefully yesterday afternoon. He was a longtime member of the congregation. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Holy and merciful God, we give you thanks and praise for your invitation to us, an invitation which comes continually, always inviting us to join you in your work. We pray, Lord, that by your Spirit we would be faithful disciples, to hear your call and to respond with our lives and our daily actions. And as we do this, Lord, we are grateful for all your goodness and the wonders of this world. We are grateful for the beauties that surround us and the mysteries of our universe. Help us to live in grateful praise, even as we pray for the needs of our world. We continue to seek your guidance for our world leaders, asking that there may be a positive outcomes from the G20 summit, as our leaders have been entrusted with great responsibilities. We pray that you would fill each of them with great wisdom, dignified self-control, and generous compassion for others. We pray for the Koreans and their neighbors, that peace would reign and missiles stay grounded. We pray for the Iraqis as they battle terrorists, that you may give them hope for a country without war. And we pray for Venezuelans struggling with a deep economic crisis, that they may find a way through shortages and chaos to a time of stability for their citizens. Lord, in your mercy. Lord Jesus, in you we find our freedom, and in you we find new life. We pray today for all those who are imprisoned, for all our citizens serving time behind bars. We pray that you would restore and uphold them, open doors of opportunities when they are released, and provide encouragement for those with long sentences. Protect prisoners who struggle with despair or violence, and help them to find ways to cope without self-harm. In prisons that are filled with tension and ongoing gang conflict, bring calm that inmates may coexist. And for those who struggle with personal forms of imprisonment, whether it be addiction or self-hatred, bring redemption and new life. Lord, in your mercy. Eternal God, we give thanks that you are our beginning and our end. You are the first and the last, the one who travels with us in each season of our journey. We give thanks for the babies in our lives, for children, grandchildren, nieces, and nephews. Bless them as they grow, surround them with dedicated, caring adults, and fill them with your love. We give thanks for those who have completed life on earth and in death have found new life in you. We praise you for the good memories and kind words they leave behind and ask that you comfort those who grieve. As you promise to be with us in each season of our lives, we ask that you be with those who are ill, that they may know your healing presence, and be with those who struggle, that they may know your strength. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, we are grateful that we can come to you in prayer, so we offer all these prayers in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. This summer, we have asked three people to give a brief testimony as to how they individually respond to God's grace. This morning, Nell Noonan will give witness to as to why she is committed to Christian education and Christian nurture.
As a young child growing up in Mississippi, I spent many days with my grandparents. Mimi was a devout Baptist and also a school teacher. At age three, she taught me to read using a book titled Stories of Jesus. I was enthralled with learning to read, but I was equally fascinated with this man called Jesus and with the stories of God and God's chosen people. Over the decades, that foundation led me to Sunday school, vacation Bible school, youth group, Bible study, both alone and in groups, and in teaching in Methodist and Episcopal churches. I served on state education committees and attended regional conferences. Additionally, being a good bibliophile, I loved libraries and received a master's degree in library science and became a librarian. But that career was interrupted when I attended my daughter's graduation here at Duke. In the program, I learned the Divinity School offered something I had never heard about, a master's degree in religious education. I was so excited, I went home and told the bishop I wanted to pursue that path. I wanted to serve the diocese with teacher training, a resource center, a newsletter, and educational events. Church leaders often grab someone from the hallway and send them into a classroom where he, she is poorly equipped to do the critical job of faith formation. Teaching done poorly can misinform and damage a person's image of God, themselves, and others. That scenario is tragic, and so I felt called to do what I could to equip the saints for educational ministry for themselves and the churches they served. I received the MRE and later the DMin and served as education minister of the Episcopal Diocese of Mississippi for several years. I served parishes in Texas and Arizona. After my husband died, I came to Durham to be near my daughter Elizabeth and my sister Mary. One of the happy coincidences has been that I found the congregation at Duke Chapel, an inclusive, welcoming church family of about 500 members. The congregation supports the chapel with ushers, altar guild, clergy in lay support, nursery, and lemonade on the lawn, among other things. But I wonder how many of you know that the congregation leadership is diligent and passionate about providing excellent educational opportunities for all ages, toddlers to seniors, with the purpose of growing, expanding, and nurturing our lifelong journey in faith. The goal is to deepen our relationship with God, others, and the world. The congregation provides this ministry and is doing it incredibly well. I'm excited about what we do, and I'm excited about my own journey in wonder, mystery, paradox, questions, discussions, and study that leads to new understandings that may help me grow to be a more faithful disciple. I remain captivated by God's love story in Jesus, such a glorious, mysterious, miraculous gift. And I invite you to investigate the educational opportunities we have to offer here.
Thank you, Nell. This morning, all of today's cash offerings and undesignated checks will be used to support human service organizations here in the Durham area. These nonprofit organizations are identified by a team of congregation members, chapel members, and students. Out of gratitude to God, let us serve God with our gifts of time, talent, and treasure.
We have so much for which to be thankful, Lord God our Father. We thank you for the breath that gives us life and enables us to sing your praises. Your grace, for which we all are in debt, draws us into the depths of the mystery of your love for us. We give you our offerings, our worship, all of our lives, so that you might use them, use us, as you will, for your purposes and your glory. Inspire the work of organizations throughout the Triangle who are working for your good, caring for people in need, and striving to make our lives together more equitable and just. Enable each of us to join Jesus as we experience, witness, and see your kingdom and your vision breaking into the world. We pray this in Jesus' name, the one who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Now may you find yourself giving up your burdens and joining Jesus as you live into the mystery of God's kingdom that is breaking into this world. And may the blessings of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you now and always. Amen.